reminding us of where we're at for those process of healing and wholeness. Whenever we're in a conversation within the group, it always begins by saying, I am Chuck, and I am a bewildered pastor. Or however you want to identify yourself. The second reading today is taken from Paul's second letter to the church at Corinth. And I thought about the 12-step process because of many of the verses that are within this particular reading. And in particular, the one that ends it. When I am weak, then I am strong. How does that sit with your experience? You say, I believe that. Foundation of my life.
Are
nothing for you. Do you believe that? And Paul embraced that message and embraced that form. That weakness, perhaps. And indeed, I believe it made him a better minister when he did that. Go back to that little phrase. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Again, how does it sit with your experience? Do you find that to be common for yourself? You know, weaknesses are something, particularly in today's climate, not something we want to deal with. We want to make America great. We don't want to talk about weakness. And so we have this message that's pushing with us. If I were to ask you to sit down and jot out your weaknesses, probably you do that rather quickly. You always got to invite people to do the same with your strengths. And you name your strengths as easily and quickly. But once we look at that list of weaknesses, what we do, either many will try to change them, or certainly we'll avoid them. I don't want to talk about that. And yet part of the mystery of Paul's experience was, could I look at any of those weaknesses as a strength? I think for myself, I try to move away from changing them, but rather surrendering to God is when the weaknesses give me power. Three examples. Crafting a homily, especially a funeral homily, is one of the times that I most feel weak at. Contrary to popular belief, they don't happen like that. But when you wrestle with the word, you wrestle with what to say, and then you have to just sort of hand that over to God. Sometimes in conversations as a spiritual director, listening to someone and being open to what the Spirit is trying to do in their life and to respond to that. Most certainly as a confessor, I'm most aware of my brokenness and my sins, and I always hope and pray that it makes me a better confessor, be filled with compassion for someone else. Sometimes that helps focus on that. There are some reflect frames that go through my head. Those that were from Keys 50th, there's a song sung at the post-communion time that is dated to the 70s. It's Take, Lord, Receive. It's based on the Suscipe from St. Ignatius in his exercises. But the refrain of that was, give me only your love and your grace. That's enough for me. Your love and your grace are enough for me. Am I able to say that today? And to believe that? That God, your grace, your love is enough for me. Flash forward to more current contemporary times, and our hymn books are sung by that honor. Again, similar words. Remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. For your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Again, in the rhythm of your day, repeat those words, you can come to believe them. That God's grace is enough. Tasks for the week ahead. Take a few moments to once again review what are your strengths, what are your